Happy National Library Week. I am also happy to introduce Barb Hauer, our Collections Development Manager, who will present today's program, Celebrating Women Artists. Part one, Helen Dryden. Part two, Elizabeth Miller. Barb has been serving as the facilitator for our Book and Brush Club since its inception in 2009, and has introduced our readership to countless artists' work with slide presentations, such as the one we will be viewing shortly.
Thank you, Jason. It is my privilege to make this presentation during National Library Week. The impetus for this program came from two Book and Brush Club selections based on the lives of women featured in the books The Masterpiece by Fiona Davis and The Age of Light by Whitney Sher. The featured artists are Helen Dryden and Lee Miller, respectively. In the first half of the 20th century, these American artists struggled to advance their careers against gender bias. Both were unaccepting of the inequalities facing women during the early 1920s and beyond. Helen Dryden was born in 1882 to wealthy Baltimore parents. Her father owned a sugar refinery business that eventually went bankrupt. While her father was swindling his business investors, Helen was designing paper dolls that were later published in a local newspaper. While she showed artistic promise at an early age, she lacked formal training, except for a few years when she studied landscape painting at the Pennsylvania Academy of Fine Arts. She said of her work, "My work is so entirely my own. It is a combination of things I like in the way I want to do them, rather than an unconscious reflection of the ideas of an admired master." In the first decade of the 1900s, she became enamored with fashion, illustration, and costume design, particularly of the Art Nouveau style of the French and Russian ballets. In 1909, she moved to New York with high hopes of selling her fashion illustrations to Vogue, who repeatedly rejected them. Condé Nast bought Vogue magazine in 1910, and soon after signed Helen to a 13-year contract, during which time she produced over 100 cover illustrations and fashion articles. In 1928, Helen became a faculty member of the Grand Central School of Art, one of its first women instructors. It was where she met the Armenian-born artist Ashil Gorky, who also taught there and provided her with encouragement and support. This slide shows a gallery of the Grand Central Art School, founded in 1924 by John Singer Sargent and other artists. It was located at Grand Central Terminal Station in New York City and operated for nearly 20 years with an enrollment of 900 students. No artist works in a vacuum, and Helen, like Gorky, learned not only from her colleagues, but also from the works displayed in the great museums and the galleries of New York City. Gorky emulated the art of Cézanne, Picasso, and Miró. His style developed from cubism to abstract expressionism to surrealism. By the 1940s, he was reputed to be a prominent abstract artist among the New York avant-garde. Gorky was noted as a masterful colorist and a consummate draftsman. In his cityscape of the rooftops of Staten Island, pictured here, the viewer notes his debt to Cézanne's paintings of mountains and forests, particularly in the loose patchwork of green, blue, orange, and yellow colors and outline forms. By the 1940s, Gorky breaks from his previous working method, whereby his strong personal identification with particular artists like Cézanne and later Miró led him to reveal his own vision of the world. Witness the transformation of his style in landscape painting in this work called Virginia Landscape, 1943. Here, Gorky uses fluid, amorphous forms and bright colors instead of outline forms, as we saw in Staten Island. These forms are drawn from his memories of bucolic Armenia, his daydreams and sexual fantasies. Similarly, Helen Dryden, who designed the Vogue covers from 1910 to 1923, was evolving her style. Maybe not to the point of surrealism, but definitely towards cubism. Her Vogue covers brought to America the popularized Art Nouveau designs from France, with its appealing curvilinear lines, bold colors, and overall decorative effect. Here is the June 1913 cover published by Condé Nast and selling for all of 25 cents. Dryden's Vogue covers feature at least one full-figured woman in an imagined setting, such as here with surrounding floral elements. While Dryden's figures are highly mannerist in form and imaginatively set against a fanciful backdrop of whirling clouds and floral and fauna elements, the viewer can't miss the prominent position of the greyhound dog, a trendy pet among the Hollywood elite. Helen included the dog as a footnote to the modern sensibilities for speed and efficiency that were occurring in American industry at the time. After 1923, Helen left Vogue magazine and designed covers for Delineator magazine. The Art Nouveau elements that Dryden used to grace her Vogue covers have become noticeably absent. The expressionless face of this mannequin figure is cropped below the neck, and her elegant hands with elongated fingers draw attention to the act of applying makeup. Background distractions are gone. Utilizing abstract forms and muted tones of color, Helen has streamlined the cover completely, indicative of Art Deco's evolution into modernity. After her stint at Vogue, Helen also dabbled in photography as well as costume design for Broadway and ballet. She became the art director of the Durer Company in Ohio, where she designed and oversaw the production of such chrome decorative objects like cigarette cases, picture frames, and clock cases, etc. In 1925, she ventured into industrial design, working for the Revere Copper Company, creating designs for housewares, lamps, and candle holders, such as this candelabra. From 1934 to 1937, Helen was hired by Studebaker for $100,000 per year, giving her the title of the highest paid woman artist. She designed the interiors of both the Dictator and the President automobiles and was deemed the only woman to invade man's domain. An advertisement for the $665 Studebaker notes the charm of the interiors that only gifted Helen Dryden could achieve. She also worked on advertising campaigns for Studebaker, as well as for other companies like Lux Soap and Martex Towels. In the 1940s, Helen disappears from public life. In 1956, she is found living on welfare in a seedy hotel in New York City and dies largely unknown in a mental asylum in 1972. Elizabeth Lee Miller is another American artist who, like Helen Dryden, forged her artistic career beginning in the world of fashion. Quite coincidentally, both women were employed at Vogue by Condé Nast. As a prototypical Vogue model, Lee Miller brings to life the caricatures that appear on the Vogue covers designed by Helen Dryden. But Miller was more than a model and muse. She was an extraordinary photographer, surrealist artist, war correspondent, and gourmet cook. And both women lived in an era that often defined the careers of women as secondary to those of their male colleagues. This photograph, taken by Man Ray, is of Elizabeth Lee Miller, later Lady Penrose. Lee was born in 1907 in Poughkeepsie, New York, to wealthy parents. Her father was a successful engineer and amateur photographer who used Lee as his model. When Lee was 7 years old, she was raped while staying with a family friend in Brooklyn, an extremely traumatic experience for her and her family. She had issues in school and was expelled from every school she attended in the Poughkeepsie area. However, her father continued to take photographs of her, and during her teenage years, he often took many stereoscopic photographs of her in the nude and in compromising positions. Her modeling career began in 1927 when Condé Nast offered her a modeling job at Vogue. She met him by chance after she accidentally stepped in front of a car on a Manhattan street. Condé Nast rescued her. He was enthralled by her chic, modern look that she acquired while studying in Paris. For the next 2 years, she became a top model for leading photographers like Edward Steichen, among others. Her stint with Vogue was over, after a photo of Miller by Steichen was used to advertise Kotex menstrual pads without her consent. Many fashion houses refused to hire her as a model because of her association with such intimate feminine products. Miller was tired of being behind the camera anyway and wanted to work on the other side of the lens. At Loose Ends, she undertook architectural studies and was hired to put fashion details in Renaissance paintings. She soon became bored with this task and traveled to Paris with a letter of introduction from Steichen to Man Ray, from whom she wanted to learn photography. Lee met Man Ray in the spring of 1929 at a Paris bar. Miller was seeking photography lessons. Ray said he wasn't taking any students and that he was leaving for vacation in Biarritz. "So am I," Lee responded, starting a very tempestuous and creative relationship. Ray was an established fashion photographer and was a significant contributor to the Dada and Surrealist movements, although his ties to each were informal. He produced major works in a variety of media, but considered himself a painter above all. He was one of the era's most original artists, noted for his work with photograms, which he called rayographs, in reference to himself. These were photographs he made without a camera, placing objects onto photographic paper and preserving their shadows. This is a portrait of Man Ray by Lee Miller, taken in 1931. To Man Ray, Lee was a physical ideal, perfectly molded, an ice blonde beauty, like a goddess, unknowable. He was crazy in love with her and treated her differently from his other sitters. In his art, he objectified her, chopping her body into parts and using them in his painting, photography, and sculptural works. Lee desperately wanted him to recognize her as an artist in her own right and not just as a model and apprentice. This is Man Ray's rayograph of Lee Miller, 1929. Man Ray and Lee Miller parted ways over the authorship of the Bell Jar series, one of which photographs is pictured here. May Ray won the Patterson Shrine Award for Portraiture from the Philadelphia Camera Society for this series of rayographs. The jury was impressed with the solarization effect that resulted when the developing film was accidentally exposed to light. Miller claims that when she was developing the negative in the darkroom, a mouse ran over her foot, so she quickly turned on the light switch. According to Miller, she took the photographs of her close friend Tanya, not only as a portrait, but also as an experiment exploring the unconscious. Nonetheless, Ray claimed the discovery of the solarization effect as his and named the resulting images as rayographs after himself. Lee consequently leaves Ray. This painting is called The Lovers or Observatory of Time, 1932 by Man Ray. This painting, covering 8 feet of canvas and over 3 feet high, took Man Ray 2 years to complete. It illustrates Lee's disembodied red lips floating high over a landscape. Ray asserts Lee's lips into a faint smile as organic forms representing male and female bodies. It has been described as the quintessential surrealist painting, figurative yet mystifying. This painting is another example of how Ray objectified Lee. He cast aside her inner beauty, focusing instead on her physical allure. As Lee became increasingly unhappy with Ray's lack of respect for her and her art, she sought new experiences and eventually left Ray. Man Ray destroys the work featured in this slide because he is so upset with her leaving him. He makes several reproductions of this work, inserting a photograph of Lee's eye. The work is called Object to be Destroyed, originally created in 1923. It consists of a metronome with a photograph and an eye attached to its swinging arm. "Cut out the eye from a photograph of one who has been loved but is seen no more," he writes bitterly. "Attach the eye to the pendulum of a metronome and regulate the weight to suit the tempo desired. Keep going to the limit of endurance. with a hammer well aimed, tried to destroy the whole at a single blow. In 1932, Miller, along with her brother, opened up Lee Miller Studios in New York City, where she was the photographer to be photographed by. Lee became very successful creating beautiful photographs of the culturally elite. She combined highly skilled lighting effects and a surrealist approach to her work. However, she soon tires of taking society portraits and in 1934 marries the wealthy Egyptian Aziz Eloy Bey and dismantles her studio to move to Cairo with her new husband. In Egypt, during her three-year marriage, Lee began documenting her new surroundings in photography. Once in Cairo, however, she concentrated on still life images and the landscape. This image of a desert landscape seen through the torn screen of a tent embodies surrealist impulses that Miller acquired early in her career while working with Man Ray. The view contrasts interior and exterior worlds, much as the surrealists contrasted the worlds of the conscious and the conscious. Perhaps the empty vistas reflect her inner portrait and the vacuous lifestyle she was living in Egypt, far removed from the stimulating art worlds of Paris, London, and New York. After 3 years in Cairo, Lee became restless again and returned to Paris, supposedly just for the summer, but meets the artist Roland Penrose and falls madly in love with him. In Mougins, France, Miller and Penrose picked up the company of their surrealist friends, including Picasso, who paints six portraits of Lee as L'Arlésien. On the brink of World War II, Miller leaves her husband and joins Roland to live in England. This is a photograph Miller takes of her new artist friends, Picasso and Penrose, at Mougins, France in 1937. This is the portrait of Lee Miller a la L'Arlésien by Picasso, 1937. Once in England, Lee became a freelance photographer and worked at British Vogue and other magazines. When war broke out in 1939, she began covering the bomb damage as well as the war efforts in everyday lives of British civilian men and women. In order to continue her war photographer, she became accredited to the U.S. Army and after D-Day went to Normandy. As a woman photographer accredited to the U.S. Army, Lee was supposed to be in a safe zone away from the front, but instead a mix-up occurred, and when she arrived, the Battle of St. Malo was still raging. Only male war correspondents had been sent to cover known battles, but she covered the battle anyway. She violated the terms of her accreditation as a woman and covered the combat. Consequently, she was later put under house arrest, but this did not stop her from catching up with the U.S. 83rd Division again and covering further battles. Lee also went on to photograph victims of concentration camps, close-ups of Nazis who committed suicide, and documented America's first use of napalm. Yes, this is the iconic photograph of Lee washing her back in Adolf Hitler's bathroom on April 30, 1945, the same day he committed suicide. Note his frame photographed in the far left corner of the bathtub, and her combat boots on the mat, and her clothes folded on the chair. Quite the photographic scoop. In 1947, Miller finally marries Roland Penrose and settles for a life in England as Lady Penrose. After the war, she suffered from alcoholism and PTSD. She put all her photographs and journals in a box in her attic. She took up gourmet cooking and entertaining family and friends at home. At the end of the 1930s, she reconciled with Man Ray. When Miller was married to the British surrealist Roland Penrose, she and Man Ray stayed close friends for the rest of their lives. They last met in London in 1975 at Ray's retrospective art exhibit at the Institute of Contemporary Art, where her husband was director. She dies July 21st, 1977.